death. Now, most of us do our best not to think about death, but there's always part of our minds that knows this can't go on forever. Part of us always knows that we're just a doctor's visit away or a phone call away from being starkly reminded with the fact of our own mortality, or of those closest to us. Now, I'm sure many of you in this room have experienced this in some form. You must know how uncanny it is to suddenly be thrown out of the normal course of your life and just be given the full-time job of not dying or caring for someone who is. But the one thing people tend to realize at moments like this is that they wasted a lot of time when life was normal. It's not just what they did with their time. It's not just that they spent too much time working or compulsively checking email. It's that they cared about the wrong things. They regret what they cared about. Their attention was bound up in petty concerns. The year after year, when life was normal. And this is a paradox, of course, because we all know this epiphany is coming. Don't you know this is coming? Don't you know that there's going to come a day when you'll be sick or someone close to you will die, and you'll look back on the kinds of things that captured your attention, and you'll think, what was I doing? You know this, and yet, if you're like most people, you'll spend most of your time in life tacitly presuming you'll live forever. It's like watching a bad movie for the fourth time. Or bickering with your spouse. These things only make sense in light of eternity. There better be a heaven if we're going to waste our time with it. There are ways to really live in the present moment. What's the alternative? It is always now. However much you feel you may need to plan for the future, to anticipate it, to mitigate risks, the reality of your life is now. Now, this may sound trite, but it's the truth. It's not quite true as a matter of physics. In fact, there is no now that encompasses the entire universe. You can't talk about an event being simultaneously occurring here and one at the same moment occurring in Andromeda. The truth is, now is not even well defined as a matter of neurology, because we know that inputs to the brain come at different moments, and that consciousness is built upon layers of inputs whose timings have to be different. Our conscious awareness of the present moment is, in some relevant sense, already a memory. But as a matter of conscious experience, the reality of your life is always now. And I think this is a liberating truth about the nature of the human mind. In fact, I think there's probably nothing more important to understand about your mind than that, if you want to be happy in this world. But the past is a memory. It's a thought arising in the present. The future is merely anticipated. It is another thought arising now. What we truly have is this moment, and this, and this. And we spend most of our lives forgetting this truth, repudiating it, fleeing it, overlooking it. And the horror is that we succeed. We manage to never really connect with the present moment and find fulfillment there, because we are continually hoping to become happy in the future. And the future never arrives. Even when we think we're in the present moment, we're in very subtle ways always looking over its shoulder, anticipating what's coming next. We're always solving a problem. And it's possible to simply drop your problem, if only for a moment, and enjoy whatever is true of your life in the present. This is not a matter of new information or more information. It requires a change in attitude. It requires a change in the attentiveness you pay to your experience in the present moment.
So what makes you paint, Knut?
Yeah, what makes me paint? What he was talking about, probably. It gives me a sense of purpose, where there is none. is there purpose to life?
I don't think so. I think all is random.
Yeah, all is random. So we have to create purpose.
How do we create purpose?
With being in the moment, I guess. Being in the moment.
In the present?
Huh?
In the present?
In the present, yeah. Present moment? Is it present or is it... Well, it's being in the moment. I mean, it fulfills me. It gives me a sense of... yeah, of purpose.
So if you went blind tomorrow, what would you do?
Yeah, that's a good question. Probably become extremely depressed for a while, and then I would start writing. I wouldn't do paint. I wouldn't be one of those blind painters that feels the color. I wouldn't do something as stupid as that. Okay.
Because
that is ridiculous. It's just, I mean, you can't feel paint. Okay. If you're a sculptor, you can probably do some sculpture with clay.
Yeah.
But you can't feel the colors. You have to see the colors. So, I mean, painting without eyes. But you know, I'm not engaged, but I care about a lot of political stuff, and I would have a lot of books in my head. So
what
would have done that?
What's the title of your books?
It's Vix 42.
Like Hitch 22?
Yeah, Hitch 42. Hitch... what was it? Hitch
22.
No, it's kind of... 2010... I was thinking about a new title to my book. The book about everything. And since the number 42 is the number of everything from The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and my name is Vikshåland, and I was actually 42 when I got the idea, and it points to Christopher Hitchens' Hitch 22, I thought it was a good title.
Yeah,
because I really love Christopher Hitchens and his...
What is it about him that you're so intrigued by?
That he doesn't compromise. That he always are consistent in being or telling what he meant. And the fact that I went from being... from no to the Iraq War, I went to a yes already in 2000, and before, so I was for the invasion of Afghanistan, and I became for the invasion of
Iraq
long before I've heard about Christopher Hitchens. So when I heard him speak about these things, just thought, yes, another one to actually, and it was almost for the same reasons. I didn't know as much about it as he did, not at all, but I mean, my reason was simple. Dictatorship is actually slavery. And I mean, Saddam Hussein was a real bastard, and I thought that would be the right thing to remove him.
But then you should remove every dictator.
Yeah, I think so. We should give them The UN should give them a proposition.
An offer?
An offer that they couldn't resist. You know, we should actually, we should stop dealing with China until they stopped supporting North Korea, for instance. We should just stop. We should go in like they did in Mali now. Or
yeah.
They should do the same thing in Syria. They should do, they should give the Iranians ultimatum. The UN doesn't do their job, so that's why the world is still burning.
The UN is a lot of different countries, and then it's their own needs before the best of everyone.
Yeah. I mean, it's actually China and the Soviet Union, the Russians who are blocking everything. Blocking North Korea, blocking Syria. They all want to block Libya too. So it's vanskelig å male og snakke samtidig.